So, to introduce three of our favorite Facebook admins, we got to pick our favorites here. So first we have Brian Copeland in the middle. Wait, I should have set the rules. Because there's three, I'm going to introduce all three, and then we're going to give them a big ol' applause. All right, so Brian Copeland, Chief Engagement Officer for The Village. He's President of Tennessee REALTORS and has appeared on numerous most influential lists in his industry. He and his spouse, Greg, live on a farm where they are raising their 3 and 6-year-olds and run an LGBT-inclusive food pantry. Brian admins over 30 communities, one being Gay Fathers throughout the world, which he founded in 2013. Haley Woods, over here in the red, founded Girls Love Travel, an international and engaging community for travel-loving women. A graduate of NYU Tisch School of the Arts and former backbending contortionist. Can we get, no? Okay. She's been a digital nomad for over six years. Haley manages a team of over 60 volunteer staff hailing from 6 continents to run this community. Through pillars of safety, socializing, and support, GLT has positively impacted lives, travel experiences, and friendships of countless women. And finally, last but certainly not least, is a wonderful Lola Omolola. Did I get it right?
Yes.
She's a community engagement strategist who partners with women who are serious about living a conscious life as a foundation for actualizing individual, family, and professional success. Her passion for women's issues led her to create and lead Female In, Finsters, an exclusive Facebook community with more than 1 million members. Finn has been a highlight as a platform for social change by Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, as a model for building meaningful communities. Lola lives in Chicago with her loving husband, 2 daughters, and widowed mother. Please, give a big old CMX for our panel.
A destination, but I got a feeling that if you're a passenger, you can let me be your passenger.
Well. Welcome.
Hi.
Well, let's first start off with telling us a bit more about your groups.
Well, I'm Brian Copeland. I'm in Nashville, Tennessee. We founded in 2013. We are a gay father group that represents fathers across the globe. So we have fathers from all from many countries and all states across the
globe. And I'm Haley, as he said, and our community with Girls Love Travel was founded December of 2015, now has over 437,000 members all across the world, and our main goal is for safety, socializing, and support, not just for the active traveler, but the wannabe traveler as well.
My group is Female In, Finn for short, and we call members Finsters. We started 24 months ago and have grown from 0 to 1.3 million in 24 months. Our core vision is really about ending a culture of silence that's causing women's voices to not be valued. And it's a sisterhood. So it's a no judgment support group for women only. But that's what Finn is.
That's amazing. So today, we talked a little bit about bringing people online, creating online community, and then helping them have real world impact. Can you share with a little bit about how you guys have done that in your groups?
I think one of the biggest things for my community is that we try and generate not only online relationships, but offline friendships. And through our sisterhood of support, it's truly a network of reach. Not too long ago, you guys all know that there was the attack that happened in Barcelona, and one of my girls, she posted in the community that she had arrived to Barcelona to find that her lodging for the evening was right in the center of the attack area, and she posted in the group and she said, you know, what do? Where do I go? Please help. Just give me some support and understanding. And in 4 minutes, a girl reached out and just said gives me chills to think about, but in 4 minutes, a girl reached out and just said 3 words and said, come to me. And they ended up messaging back and forth, and in less than 45 minutes from the time that she did her original post, then she was posting again pictures of them around the dinner table taking pictures and sharing stories.
It's very impactful when you have a community where people, there's so many people who are just waiting to help make a difference for you. In my community, a specific story stands out. There was a woman, at that point we had only started about a month earlier, and a woman shared her story saying, I live in London, and as I speak, I'm on the highway, and I'm contemplating driving right off of it. She was contemplating suicide. But just the beauty of community is that so many women, comment after comment, just came to the group. They were frantically attempting to save her life. This is a woman they don't know. And there, of course, my role as an admin, or air traffic controller, I like to call myself, is to ensure that I'm not only admining or managing or protecting the heart of the person who is expressing what's going on with her, but it's also imperative that we make sure that people, members of the group, do not say anything to trigger the situation or to make it worse. So that is our responsibility, and that is what our community has been able to achieve, and it's amazing.
And when we look at fathers, we have fathers who also work in foster care. So
I go to a story.
Good gravy, this doesn't like me. Is it because I'm gay? What? back to center. So we have one of our fathers in the group from Miami, Florida, and he runs a foster agency. Two little children, I won't use their names, had been returned to the system three times because no one wanted these kids. And so he posted in the group to say, I need help. I've got two amazing children who just cannot keep a home. Literally returned three times. So two of our fathers in the group stepped up and said, I think it's where I'm sitting. Two of our fathers stepped up in the group and said, we will take these children. I have a military background. My husband has a background in education. And so they called me from the Florida state line saying, this has been the worst night of our life. It's like watching an exorcism of these two children trying to adapt to our family. But we're going to stay in there. And to this day, 3 years later, Paris and her brother have a home right in Nashville, Tennessee, thanks to real life in-life engagement that happens real life online.
And I should mention the outcome of that story was a really good one. She ended up deciding to stay alive, and she ended up being a member, a very active member on our group, and she had more stories to tell, and those stories were about her excitement about being with us and not taking her own life anymore. And there's a lot of stories like this, and the good news is a person who used to feel that she was by herself now knows that she has an entire community of thousands, hundreds of thousands of women who care about what's going on with her and who can make direct change for her and go to her house, help her with childcare, help, you know, give her a place to live, and you know, basically take her troubles away.
Now, those are amazing, powerful stories. I'm going to turn the questions a little bit and talk about something a little grittier. Many people at CMX today are professional, full-time community builders. So in your day-to-day, when you're thinking about your group and what you do, what are some of the challenges? What are the difficult parts? Let's talk about that.
The difficult part is making sure that people feel safe. And because I noticed that it is necessary for us to feel comfortable in a space before we tell our stories, before we feel comfortable expressing what's going on with us. I particularly serve a community in which women are not used to talking about deep issues that are relating to their personal experience. They don't just talk about it. We come from, actually, probably might help to put it in context for you. My group started as female in Nigeria. And therefore, the geographic connection was with Nigerian women, women who grew up in a system where a woman's voice was not really valued. And that is what, could you ask me the question again?
What are some of the biggest challenges with your group?
So the major challenge was trying to show people a brand new way to think, because that's what my community is about, is helping people to see things from a different perspective where they can see that it's okay to tell their stories, that it's okay to say, this is here I am. And it should be okay for them to be able to do that. I mean, they're adults after all. So the biggest challenge was trying to impress upon them that we will support them and we will be there beyond just the virtual space, that we will hold their hand through telling their stories, and we would stamp out the voices of anyone who's there to judge them. And that's what we've done unsuccessfully, because the group believes us.
And when I look at brand, I want to talk a little bit to you guys who are managing banks and furniture stores and grocery stores and those kind of things, because one of our challenges is language. How are you including us in your language? Do you think, as a community manager, when you're putting something out that says, hey, moms, what do you think about this? You're excluding an entire demographic here. Also, think about the language that you're using, whether it be, if you're using husband, wife, think about spouse. Think about the terms when you're community managing. One word can derail an entire area. So you've got to watch every single word as a community manager before you hit send on that message. Have I looked at every word? Will one of these words derail a conversation? I have found in my group, for example, if we just focus on the fathers of surrogacy, well, we've got fathers who come through foster care. We have some who came through divorce. We have to make sure we're using language that includes all of our fathers. So as a community manager, I hope you will take our challenge that we've seen and think about what you send out to make sure it includes all people and watch every word you say.
I think for our community, it's kind of a twofold tactic, because with us nearing 500,000 members, we have a lot of people that don't see us as just the social community, but see it as a self-profiteering space and wanting to figure out where is that line. And for us, one of the things that we did is we started from the start. I mean, when I started the community not so long ago, I started it out of my own loneliness and looking for like-minded sisters, like-minded friends all around the world to be able to talk about travel and explore. And I honestly thought that it was going to be maybe 1,000 or 5,000 members top. So I never expected it to get to the level that it is, and it continues to grow. And so when I started it, I thought, okay, I needed everyone to identify as female and to be kind. And that's great, and that's still part of our foundation, but presently we now have guidelines in place that is about a 20-page document to be able to really go and dissect how to support the community. And then we, on top of that, we have a 4-week training program for our moderators to make sure to understand and actualize and empathize and talk in the language of our voice of our community. But second tier to that, I would say, would be the self-profiteering, because you have to listen to your community as it stands for you. And for us, so many people were coming in wanting to follow me, add me, vote for me, those kind of things. And so the way that we help support that is that every week we have a post that I called Toot Your Own Horn. And it comes up on Tuesday. They can self-profiteer as much as they want and self-promote as much as they want on Tuesday, but we take it down on Friday. And I think that that's something that a lot of times doesn't get discussed when it comes to community building, is that beginning, middle, and end for engagement of some of those tactics, because having it come down means it's not just a never-ending ad space. It's a space for those that want it, they find it, and then for those that don't want it and really want it to continue to be the community of support that it is, then it's just there for a limited time.
Wonderful. So we talked a lot about your top challenges. Now, one challenge I think all community managers face is when somebody comes into the group for the first time, there's a lot going on. They gotta learn the rules, learn the culture, and at first, everyone is a stranger. So can you share some advice and tips on how you guys have done that in your group?
Well, the newest is the tools that you have implemented with the new badges. So recently, the new badges not only say admin and moderator, but for the first 14 days of a member in a group, it says new member. And so being able to utilize that tool to see, because in my community at least, we have found that usually within the first 3 months of a person being in the community, you can hear their voice if they're coming in just to profiteer, if they're just trying to self-promote, or if they're truly looking for a community to be a part of. So really seeing the new members and helping out. And the other thing that we do because of that tool is that we've come to find that that first post, that first opportunity to connect, truly sets the standard for if they're going to want to post again, if they're going to want to be engaging again. And because we have that in place, we're able to help bump up their post, engage in their post, and make them feel even more welcome.
It's a little different in my group. In order for people to understand that we have a culture in place, we've been able to create a space where no judgment, you can't judge people. So we have policy posts that make that very clear. And most of the time, we repost those policy posts. That therefore, there's a new person coming into the group, they're able to see right away that there's something different about this space. When comment after comment, people are just kind. So it's very unusual on the the internet, because you go to spaces and everyone is, you know, there are trolls everywhere. We all know the bad actors are always there lurking. But that doesn't, that's the first thing that you notice when you get into my group, that people are kind. I mean, people, I would see people in my inbox saying, why is everyone so nice? And I said, because that's what we are about. Our space is a non-judgmental space, because the, well, I guess the priority is the heart of the person who has given us the honor of sharing her story with us. So we want to hear that story. We don't want you to tell her what she should be doing differently. These are things that happened in the past. You can't change her story. You can only give her the clarity with which to make better choices moving forward. And the only way to do that is to really be kind and be compassionate and show some empathy. So automatically, that wave of kindness hits anyone who's coming onto the group. And another thing, and I think this is also really life-affirming, is that the admins are great at what we do. We've gotten so good at paying attention to the temperature. I mean, you know, we pay attention to what's going on constantly. There's almost 30 moderators on my group, for instance, and their job is to patrol. They make sure they're watching to protect the primary. And the primary on our group is the person who's posting her story, who's giving us the honor of hearing our experience. So seeing that they will be protected makes them feel calm. And then we also say explicitly on the rules that you should take some time out before you start engaging on this group. We need you to pay attention to see the way we do things before going into it, because we will ban you for making the wrong comment. We will ban you for being mean. We will ban you for putting the wrong GIF or emoji on a post. So, you know, that's one way we've been able to help people understand that there's a culture here, and you have to either fit in or you can leave.
As a community administrator, you are the steward of your community. You've been given this great responsibility. I call it endearment, the art of digitally engaging your clients and community with your brand, so that endearment piece. And I look and say, we're very big about welcoming everyone. When you walked into the tables out here today, all of you had this look on your face like, oh my gosh, should I wear pink on Wednesday and Mean Girls? It was like, am I supposed to sit at this table or not? Okay? And so I call this the ugly baby syndrome in our group. Because, let's face it, come on, y'all. Everybody's got an ugly baby. We all say babies are pretty. Some babies are ugly. Well, I spoke it into the world. It's out there now. So we got those fathers who, you know, they'll post things and, you know, everybody comments all the cute babies. And it's like it's got 700 likes and all these comments. And then we have one that doesn't get any comments. I know. So as an admin team, we've made it a very specific look to say, who's not getting the engagement? And you can engage people as a community person by tagging them. If you're in something like, if you're using these online programs here, you can tag people. You can say their name. People like to see that name and pop up. Higher Logic has that in their functions here even. And Facebook, you can tag here also. People like to revisit that. They like to see likes. They like to see comments on their posts. So as a admin team, we make sure that we are stewarding every person and endearing them to our brand.
Awesome. I think we have time for one last question. So, you know, what community builders do? Hard work, day in, day out. So what keeps you guys motivated and going back?
in my community, seeing women feel comfortable around other women is a beautiful driving force, especially in an environment where women don't make really meaningful connection with each other. There's so much distrust, and people are not getting together to have real relationships. You could know someone for 25 years and know absolutely nothing significant about her and call yourselves BFFs. So this, just seeing that shift happen and see people being able to form meaningful bonds because they're sharing their lives, they're sharing their experience, they're sharing their hearts and choosing to be vulnerable and then doing it around a million people, you know, at that scale. So just seeing women get out of their shell and, you know, learning to trust and learning to tell their own stories and learning self-actualization is what drives me. Nothing more. It's more powerful than anything else. I would get up to do that for the rest of my life.
So I love the members of the community and the fact that I get to meet them. I just flew in for this. I had just been in Australia and New Zealand on a three-week trip with my mom and got to meet over 100 girls over the course of that three-week trip and meet them in person. But I also have to say that in our community, too, I was able to go to Australia and New Zealand last year, combined both trips for less than $450 because of the deals that were found in the community. So it's one of those things to talk about, like the impact of the social dynamic that we are building and the bonds that we're building of friendships. But we're also having a great time being able to find deals and tips and tricks to help you in a very lighthearted way as well. So it's that combo that keeps me up until 5 in the morning talking to someone in Uganda, or the fact that Nairobi is our 19th most popular city in the world, and being able to find people and discover more areas around the world through my community.
Two of our fathers, one was a foster child himself. He remembers 30 years ago showing up at foster homes with only a trash bag full of clothes. When his children arrived at his house for foster care, all three of them had trash bags full of clothes. And our group rallied behind them to say, we're not going to let kids go with trash bags to houses anymore. So they started these comfort packs. And our group has rallied behind these fathers. They were just on the Ellen Show a few weeks ago. And to say that we're going to stand behind these families. So you, again, go back to this idea of you're stewarding communities. And we know that communities, back to that Gandhi principle, is be the change you want to see. And all of you are change agents in what you're doing. And I personally thank you for being change agents in our communities.
Well, thank you guys so much for sharing with us today. And thank you guys.
Thank you so much.